My name is Michael Wong. Some of you guys know me, some of you guys haven't. If you don't know me, I have lots of titles. All that means is that I've done nothing to get these titles. I don't really know why they keep coming to me, but it just means that I'm involved in a lot of things. One of my principal interests is, one of my principal research interests is transactional memory. And in fact, I am the chair of the Transactional Memory Study Group, SG5. There are 13 SGs, by the way, at the C++ standard. And I'm the chair for that group, tasked with trying to bring transactional memory into C++, okay? There are many other people behind the scene. I'll show you some of that, but and I'll do it right now. In fact, there's so many people, it's hard to enumerate them, and I have to always acknowledge them. But I always say that in my slides, it's generally a collection of slides that's taken from various members, various communities, research, academia, and standard. All the good stuff still remained mine, though. All the errors is some, no, just kidding. Just like anything else, any errors that remain is usually mine, because as I'm transcribing them, that's usually how it comes out. I even stole this slide from one of them. So, okay, so just a quick look at why transactional memory. In one word, in one slide, and if you only want to come here for this part, you can leave now, because this is basically it. People have actually asked me throughout, you know, what is the, and that's understandable. If you haven't heard about it, if you heard about it as a fad or whatever, what is the big deal? I can summarize in these three points. It's supposed to be as easy to use as coarse-grained logs. It scales as well as fine-grained logs. I'm giving you a picture of what fine-grained logs and coarse-grained log looks like. What the big difference is that because logs don't compose, meaning they can't be called in and out of libraries, this is supposed to give you safe and scalable composition, and therefore preserve that all important idioms that we have all relied our software career on, which is composition of libraries. You rely on the fact that you can call libraries, which themselves cause libraries. That is just completely untenable in logs. You have no idea what logs might be taken in a library. You cannot call logs and then call a library, because at some point you're going to get into this thing called deadlocks. It might not be today, it might be tomorrow, the day after, or a year after the thing goes in the field. It will happen. Okay, so I tend to push the research a little further to see where I think the world is going, and this is what I'm working on now. All right, so this talk, I'm going to talk a fair bit of stuff. Mostly, I'm going to talk about why was it C++ standard accepted. Maybe something fairly far out. Some of you might call it a little bit experimental. I wouldn't, because I'm in this field and I know where the technology stands. Why? What was the motivation? And we went to the standard and presented three motivational cases. Use cases, where is TM most useful? How is it more usable than current locks? And where is it giving you the best performance? There are studies that have been done on that, on major software, not just toy cases. Yes, I know about that paper, is transactional memory just a research toy? I was one of the contributors was actually an author of that from IBM as well too. But sometimes you just have to do something like that to wake people up and get their attention, I guess. But I'm going to talk a little bit about language constructs, maybe about half an hour, I hope, depending on how far I get. And I'll talk about a little bit about the progress and how close it is to getting to a standard. Okay. So right now it's not syncing. Why is that? I'm just going to cut this out again, because it's not syncing with me, and I don't know why. Just try this again. All right. Still not syncing. What is going on here? Let's see. View.
All right, doesn't matter. I'll just keep moving on. All right, so where were you in 1993? I mentioned that date because it is seminal in so many ways. Well, if you think back, John Major at that time was Prime Minister of Great Britain. Canada had three prime ministers, believe it or not, we just couldn't decide. Bill Clinton was the President of the United States. At that time, the EU was formally established. And around in that year, the Intel Pentium chip became the hot chip. And this little thing called World Wide Web, I don't know if you've heard of it, it became some of the hottest software in the world. Okay? And about the same time, Maurice Herlihy and Elliot Moss wrote this seminal paper called Architectural Support for Lock-Free Data Structures. That was 1993. It wasn't that long ago, if you think back. And at that time, if you do research, you write research papers, it got about all of 10 citations, which, as you know, if you do research, it's just not that great. It got that until 2005, okay? And then at that time, you heard about the multi-core, the free lunch, and now you get about 80,000 hits on Google and about 2.7 million on Bing. I don't actually know why it's like that, but that's the way it is. Okay. Now next, I'm going to try to advance properly because it's just not following me around, and I don't know why. All right. So where does it sit? Okay. I always try to put this slide up. It's not mine. It actually came from Leslie Lamport, actually, who's at Microsoft right now, because I wanted to give you an idea that where do things stand in terms of the overall scheme of parallel and concurrency. And this slide gives a reasonable summary. If you've been working in it as long as I have, or even if you're just getting into it, you hear a lot of different words being thrown about. You hear words like asynchronous operations. You hear the words like throughput, race-free, responsiveness, isolation. The fact of it is that many of these sometimes do mean the same thing, but many a times they do mean different things to experts. And in my view, when I think about it, I try to break it down into three columns. And if you do this, it will help you a lot too. When you hear something about concurrency, where does it actually fit in this column? Column one here on the left side says that, so right now we can separate into three things: asynchronous agents, concurrent collections, and mutable shared state. With asynchronous collections, it's all about tasks that can run independently through communications or messages. Probably the best example of that is a printing task that you want to dispatch out while you're editing on Microsoft Word. That's an asynchronous operation. You don't want that to be locked together in any way. And the key metric there is obviously responsiveness. You can tell if it's responsive. The next column talks about the operations on groups of things to exploit parallelism in data and algorithm structures, trees, quicksort compilations. And the key metric there is about throughput, many cores. You're really using all the cores all the way through, okay? And then the last one is about avoiding races and synchronizing objects in shared memory. There's actually been a disproportionately large amount of talks this week about that, interestingly enough. And it's all about the fact that if you still use global variables, or some variants of that, you are going to get some kind of data race if you don't take care to think about it closely. And there are methods that to deal with that. You use locks, you use mutexes, you use conditioned variables. And at a very low level, you can use lock-free programming. Paul McKinney talked about recopy update, atomics. I'm taking this to the next level. What the standard has right now is today's abstraction to service each of these columns. To service asynchronous agents, you have threads and messages. To service concurrent collections, we have thread pools, and to some extent, OpenMP. There's going to be more. To service mutable shared states, you have logs, log hierarchies, and atomics. That's where we are today. What I'm trying to do is push forward to the next advanced abstraction, as I was trying to do in 2005. To service asynchronous agents, some of the standard already has a higher level abstraction called futures, package tasks, promises. Concurrent collections, we're working on this. This is SG1's parallelism TS. If you heard, I think Yared's talk yesterday about what that is, it gives you sort, parallel sort, vec, okay? It also has seek as well too for the sequential version, which is what we have today. So this gives you ability for throughput, bang on all the cores at the same time. The last part, we don't have any advanced abstraction for in the C++ standard or the C standard or anything. It's about the idea that you have to now take it to the next level, which is either some sort of ordered hierarchical locking enforced by either goodwill or rules so that you know how to hierarchical lock things through various layers of software composition, or transactional memory. That's what we're doing research on these days, is we're trying to push it to the next level of advanced abstraction. Does that help? I think that really sets it up for me, right, when I think about these things. So let's take a look at this. I'm going to hit you with one problem right away. Transactional memory. First, a little bit of back study. What does it mean? What is transactional memory again? This is a very simple slide that talks about it. Okay. It appears to execute atomically. You probably already know that. Its implementation is going to allow transactions to run concurrently, but the results must be equivalent to some sequential execution. It's really just a form of optimistic speculation. I hope there's nobody that contends with me. So let's keep going until somebody does. And I'll show other forms of it. Okay. So for instance, in this particular execution, I have a T1 and a T2. Okay. And I do various things. Even though I use the word atomic, I don't mean in this sense the C++ 11 atomic here. I mean transaction, which is sometimes often called just an atomic block. If I do T2 then T1, I can get these particular results. If I do T1 then T2, I can get these particular results. Both are valid. Because there's nothing in the rule that says one has to go before the other. The only thing that is invalid is what's called a sequentially consistent result using interleaving, such that you do some operations from T1, and then some operations in T2, and go back and do some operations from T1. You get this incorrect result here, because it breaks atomicity. I now can see what is inside the bodies of these things. Okay? How are we so far? I tend to be much more animated in my talk, but I need to go slow here because I do realize some of this stuff is pushing the edge a little bit. So feel free to stop me and advance me at different rates. Now here's something that's actually been tried, and it is getting fairly popular again now. It's another form of optimistic speculation. Basically, it's called lock elision. It says when you need the lock, don't acquire it. Often it's better to beg forgiveness rather than ask for permissions first. Believe it or not, this works. Just don't acquire the lock. For the most part, if nobody contends with you, you've saved yourself the cost of acquiring a lock. And if you make it all the way without a synchronization conflict, then bless the temporary results and push it all the way through. There have been hardware that have gambled on this, and it was called, that was called Azul. It was a hardware system that actually essentially encapsulated this. Today, Intel's Haswell, the transactional memory design, one half of that TSX uses this lock elision technique. Okay? It allows you to pretend like there's no lock and just keeps going. But you have to do something to get it. You can't just, so there's some systems where you can get it implicitly without you having to do anything. And then underneath, it implements a rollback mechanism. Intel's don't do that. They don't actually speculate the speculation. You have to ask it to speculate the speculation by putting, I think it says XTM, whatever the name, I think it starts with X. When you ask for it, you get this. I asked them a couple of times, why did you choose to do that? And they said, well, this just feels safer for you. Okay. If you went all the way, and the other companies are now pushing to pass that point, where they're just going to speculate for you whether you asked for it or not. Okay. I keep having to switch back and forth, but that's what's going to happen. So why transactional memory? How is it different than atomics that you guys have heard throughout the week? Well, and a transaction is an atomic sequence of steps intended to replace the common use of locks. You see, simple atomic operations like CAS and low-link store conditional only really work on a memory location or a contiguous memory location, but not a discrete diff sets of memory locations that sprinkle all over the place. That's where, and there's no way you can atomically do that. If you try, that is not an atomic operation, okay? You will, and transactional memory is the only way to get you to that stage. So, what is transactional memory again? Well, these are properties you guys have heard, of course. This mostly came from databases, of course. So a lot of people in systems programming believe that all the great ideas in systems programming somehow emerged from IBM. Jim Gray on databases. The problem was that at IBM, they used some cryptic language, which as far as I can tell is not normal Indo-European language. When I first got to IBM 20 years ago, it was like that, actually 22, whatever now. You actually don't boot a system, you IPL it. I don't know. It took me years to figure out that, man. This is how they speak. It's not a disk, it's a DASDI. Heard of that? So, a couple of researchers thought that, you know what, you can pretty much make your name by stealing these ideas, reinterpreting these IBM acronyms into actual English. So they stole the ideas from database, and hence you have the asset property. And you've heard of it. It stands for atomic, consistent, isolated, and durable. Atomic meaning each transaction either commits or aborts. This is very common in SQL databases. Either the transaction happened or it didn't, okay? It's consistent. They appear to take effect in a one-at-a-time order. That slide I showed back, one in front of the other or the other one in front of you, you just don't know which. They appear isolated from other operations. The effects are not seen until the transaction has committed, okay? Durable is the persistence aspect. They implement it by putting things onto the disk itself. The DASDI, I guess, in databases. It doesn't apply in transactional memory as much, okay? So there are some things I do have to address. Whenever I give talks like this, I do have to address if there's some people who might hate transactional memory. It could be inefficient. That's probably the most serious issue and question that we have to deal with. Yes, it can be inefficient. And with hardware, that's gonna cut a lot of that out. And later on, I'm gonna show a work on Quake, which is show that it can be efficient even in a pure software environment. That's really the issue here. Yes, we know if you got hardware assist, it's gonna be fast. Is it fast enough in a pure software environment? Because many of you guys might not have a Haswell chip or a Power 8 chip, okay? I don't know what chip are you?
We're just running on regular whatever Intel processor.
So it's a software, it's a pure software. So this applies to you.
Yeah.
Other people says TM's never gonna catch on, it's just use functional programming. Well, the problem is to adapt to any new functional programming, you have to wipe out pretty much all your legacy code. That's just never gonna fly in our world. Shared memory is doom, transactional memory is evil because it makes shared memory easy to use. I don't even know how to respond to that. And this one, what concurrency crisis? There's nothing wrong with what we do today. I just use one thread. All right, just stay there. It's too early. The last one I do agree with, TM still is not gonna make your application parallel. It's not gonna make you a better parallel programmer. And I'll show that in one of the studies that they've done. So, where exactly are we in this hype, you know, hype on transactional memory? This is called the Gartner hype cycle. And it's typical of any technology in many ways. If you're doing iPhones or stuff like that, there's usually some technology trigger, and then it reaches some peak of inflated expectations. TM is so great that it will pay your mortgage. It doesn't pay a mortgage. I worked on this for 5 years and I still have a mortgage, six now. And then and once you realize it doesn't pay your mortgage and do your laundry, you reach some sort of trough of disillusionment. This really sucks. This technology isn't getting me anywhere. And usually with any technology, it plateaus to some reasonable productivity. So the trough, I feel that we are now pretty much coming out of this disillusionment and is potentially reaching up to the crest of this point here with the introduction of popular hardware that can support this. Okay. Just gonna check my time here. Okay. And I'll justify that hopefully with some studies. There are languages that support TM, quite a number of them. I'm not gonna go over them. You can take a look at each one of these yourself. So how did this get started? Well, discussion started in as far back as 2008, when Intel, Sun, and IBM started in July. And then we got a whole bunch of people together in academia, primarily because these companies were the primary candidates that were interested in this specification to deliver something in hardware. We released something by 2009, 2011. We brought it to the standard for 2012 for admission. I showed them a talk similar to this. Actually, it was Justin that showed it. And then essentially, that's when it says, let's get together and start an SG. And it's been about 2 years now. And we are now close to TS ratification. So what is hard about integrating TM to C++? We didn't choose C. We didn't choose Fortran. We could have. Well, it's hard because we like doing hard things. You wouldn't be doing what I do if you didn't like doing hard things. Because if you got to make sure it works with the C++ at that time of 0x, and I've kept it on the slide since then. The memory model, the atomics, the memory initializer syntax, the expressions, work with legacy code, how does it work with exceptions, multiple entry points, polymorphism, the list just goes on. There's a lot of hard things we got to deal with. We've been trying to successfully deal with many of these things. So what's the design goal here? We're going to build on the C++11 specification. At some point, it's going to transfer to C and Fortran as well, too, I hope. You've seen some of the talk that it uses the fundamental thing that says undefined behavior gives you what's called, race conditions give you what's called the undefined behavior. And you see people set little fires. There's actually a name for that. It's called the catch fire semantics. It means that when you have these kinds of race conditions, your hair's on fire or the whole room's on fire and people are running in every different direction. Gives you a kind of a good imagery of what that might mean. We don't use a lot of keywords. We do use a few. We want to restrict the construct to essentially enable static checking. Because we think that it's hard enough that we think that it's better if the compiler can help you as much as possible. So that that comes with a burden because static checking implies viralness, right? Cons is like a static check. But you see how viral it is? You make one function cons, you got to make everything it calls a const. Something similar is going to happen here. Although we do have alternatives, and we show that alternatives in the last meeting, the standard committee told us to revert back to the previous design, which was full static checking. Exceptions is a big, big problem with respect to transactional memory. Do you abort? Do you commit when an exception occurs? Do you roll back? Different people feel different choices are right. And as a result, we never made a choice. We said that you have all three choices available to you and you must pick. Maybe with more experience through the TS reuse, through the use with actual hardware, you will find out. Okay. All right. So I'm going to go through, I'm not going to have time right now, I can see, to go through all these use cases. So if you don't mind, I'm going to pick and choose. But I want to hit you with the first one right now, because it's the most compelling one. You guys went to some template programming talk, heard about template programming, knows that generic programming, you guys all done that? All right. I'm going to make a newsflash right now. Generic programming will not work with locks. Never will, never have, and it will never work. Here's a reason. And I talked about these deadlocks before, right? If you have one thread that takes an M1 log followed by an M2 log, and then another thread that takes an M2 and M1 log, it's only going to be a matter of time that generates that has a deadlock. This is a general well-known parallel programming problem. And in a more realistic situation, you might say, oh, obviously these are toy examples and nobody's gonna make this mistake. But the reality is that this mistake can be made very easily. So here's how that can happen. If you have thread one the way I have it here, and your thread two is just a template function, which takes a unique lock, okay? But it takes a unique lock on a particular type, T, okay? After it's been instantiated with a particular type. The problem is, you don't know if in that T there's some other lock that could happen. And the way you don't know that is here. See this little equal sign? This is a callback. Any kind of template instantiation is actually going to be some sort of callback to the equal operations in that T class. That assignment operation is going to call that particular assignment operator in the T class, and it might have a lock. It might even have another unique lock holding a different lock. Okay? You have no idea of knowing that, and it's not your job to know about that, because you are the client. That's the library that's being provided. Okay? So the reason goes like this. What lock exactly does X equal Y acquire? Well, it depends on the type of T. It could be different for every T. The author of F shouldn't need to know that, because that would violate another principle known as modularity. But let's say it's going to be share putter of TT. Well, again, now we have another iteration. It depends on locks acquired by TT's destructor, which probably depends on its member destructor, which I definitely shouldn't need to know about, which might include another share pointer of TTT. It just goes on. And this was for a relatively unrealistically simple F. For any kind of template that's fairly large, it is just going to become untenable. So the group that we're in sees this problem, and that's why we are tasking to try to solve it for you before you realize that there's something wrong there. There's basically no realistic rules for avoiding a deadlock. Some solution for that? Ban locking completely in generic programming. Could you live with that? No. Some people have seriously suggested that. I don't know. Like, if you want C++ to be fully usable in many contexts, many kinds of applications, you just can't ban locking. Okay? Because that's what this means to some extent. However, if I change that from a lock to a transaction, I now have transaction calling, I've now wrapped X equals Y into a transaction. And the class implementation might look something like this for the assignment operator. And now, magically, in a very simple two-line written case, I have now made it composable, and it's impossible to deadlock. So that's what we're offering, a future that takes us past that path. We always have thought that enforced locking ordering can avoid deadlocks. But what we're showing here is that this is impossible with template programming. And it's pervasive in C++. And of course, don't we already know this? Well, maybe. But the impact has been totally underestimated. Templates are basically everywhere. Now, this is a key statement. You've always thought transactional memory programming gives you performance, right? It's not the only thing. It means that you actually need it for functional correctness of generic programming with logs. And that's a bit of a shocking news for many people. Okay, I'm gonna get past that because I wanna get through some of these. All right, what are the use cases? Just like any new technology, it doesn't work with everything in the world, okay? And I'll show you where those cases don't work. These are the cases, and the standard asks this. We're okay if it doesn't work well with everything. One other thing that doesn't work well, by the way, which I will show, is a very common thing known as printing. It doesn't work with printing. Thank you. But it does work if you're doing computations on structures and data. And these are the kind. Irregular structures with low conflict frequency, low conflict structures with high read sharing and complex operations, read mostly structures with frequent read-only operations, and composable modular structures and functions. Okay. Because of time, I'm just going to go through one of them fairly quickly. But irregular structures look like this. They have different. They have irregular data points. Common applications are like graph applications with minimal spanning forest trees, as well as VPRs and FPGA. The thing that I want to get to, though, is this one. Obviously, you can see how complex if you try to do locking on that structure is. Paul McKinney talked about the recopy update, and he showed. I challenged him in Issaquah to demonstrate how hard it is to do a similar update of a multi-structure where you have to atomically move one element from the left to the right, from the left to the right tree, and another element from the right to the left tree, and have no contention between these two moves. He wrote a 30-page paper. Took him a week, and he is a genius. He is so far above me that I'm awed at what he's talking about. Okay. And you heard, I don't know if you, some of you guys might have heard his talk, but that was the Issaquah challenge. The reason I challenged it was, I don't even know why he did it, because he's actually ranked above me, but I work for him. So it's not often that your boss actually do something you want him to do. You know what I mean? You ask him to do something, he ignores it. I asked them because I wanted people to see what it takes if you don't have transactional memory and you have to do this just doing pure logs. And here I'm not even talking about templates or anything like that because he doesn't work with templates, he just works with C. So this is another reason why if you have something that is that complex and you can abstract it down to a reasonably simple abstraction, then that's what the standard does for you. It should be in the standard that way. All right. So. It was this. It was a low conflict structure with high read. So it's basic red-black trees and things like that. The advantage, of course, is ease of parallelization, high concurrency. So it's a basic tree like this, just like what he's demonstrated. Okay, you're updated by thread one, it can be updated by, and then the other branch is updated by thread two. All right? And the basic thing you do is you just use a basic insert and a delete operation. This is what I would do. Okay, I would wrap atomic cancel, which I haven't introduced yet, to the insert of the tree, and atomic no except around the delete of the tree. But if you want to do it together, I would do it like this. I would do atomic cancel on the delete of the tree of x from t1, and the insert of x into tree 2. That's the move, and then I would add atomic cancel to the other operation. I would do the delete from tree 2 of y, and then the insert of tree 1 from y. That's all I would do to replace this 30 pages of code. Okay. How is it that I can do this? Well, that's because these are some of the best conditions for transactional memory. They're low inherent conflict, irregular structures and operations. Okay. And one of the benefits of RCU, recopy update, is that it benefits in read-mostly structures, in structures where most of the time you're just reading and there's a few writes and updates going along. Okay. All right, I'm gonna skip past these because I am gonna hit one user study. There were two user studies I brought along from research. One is by Rosbeck it's a three-year study of undergrad classes. I can summarize it fairly quickly. It's trying to compare if what he split his graduate student teams into multiple teams and asked them to program a parallel application. It's a sync shooting gallery. And he wanted to see which one, and wanted that somebody would use locks, then they would use condition variables, they would use coarse-grained, fine-grained, and transactional memory along the way. They actually use a very old transactional memory implementations from Java. The end result wasn't surprising. Initially, it was hard using transactional memory because the syntax wasn't well defined in that DSTM that they were using from Java. As they progressed, they found TM to be much more usable. The error rates dropped down significantly. That's what all these next few slides essentially is going to show. Okay. Analyzing program error was interesting. This is showing how many, what kind of errors came from. Like, did they forget to do the release of an acquire lock right here? Okay. Did they use some condition variable which they forgot to set properly? It was interesting to see that for most of the TM, the error rate was a lot lower compared to the other ones. And this just says they did it in year one of the students' life through graduate school, then second year and the third year. Okay. The overall error rates was also interesting, but I don't want to go through that too much. Let me see. I want to get to the next group. The locks were about 58 to 75%, and transactional memory was down to about 8 to 20% of error rates. That's really what it comes down to. Nobody is going to find parallel programming easy, even with transactional memory. This is an attempt to bring it down to a more human level of achievability. Okay. There were some TM problems at that point because they were using an earlier implementation. They found lack of documentation and tutorial was made it difficult and challenging. I don't know what your experience was, Brett, with some of that now.
We've added a few people since we've been using transactional memory, and they come up to speed quick. Usually they make dumb mistakes for a month.
Yeah.
And then after that, they're great.
You should write a research paper on your experience. I think that's worth it to contribute.
I'm glad about it.
Yeah.
Right now.
Okay. If you like right me, now. If you like some collaboration, I'd be happy to help you with that. So the students generally found TM was harder than coarse-grained locking, but it was easier than fine-grained lockings and condition variable. Of course, that's exactly what we want to see. Coarse-grained locking is easy. Plop one lock at the bottom, plop an unlock at the bottom. I mean, yeah, sure, but it's not scalable. Fine-grained locking is hard because you gotta make it move in and out of scope properly. This is encouraging, okay? Continuing forward, there were a bunch of other things. There was a study on transactional memory versus locks in practice by Victor Van Pancratius. It was a search engine desktop search engine using locks, parallel regions, and condition variables, and then ultimately TM. And there was some interesting data that came out of that. I have to reposition myself to here. The most interesting thing about this was that this actually used, at the time, a pure STM from Intel, the Intel Software Transactional Memory Alpha or early compiler. It was something like 16 students, 16 small samples. Some used locks, some used locks plus TM. The best TM, it turned out that the best TM queries were orders of magnitude faster than the best locking implementation query out of that. And I'll show some of that. The lines of code turns out to be about the same. STM turned out to spend a lot less time in parallelization synchronizations, and they mostly, after they got it working, they mostly went on to look at performance optimization. They were able to get to optimization a lot faster. The TM spent less overall in terms of time. The conclusion is promising. The team that actually had the most experienced parallel programmer did not do well, and they were forever immortalized as bad programmers. So the bad programmers still write bad programs, even with transactional memory, not surprising. Okay, so let me just go back to here and go back up to this point here. What do I want to show out of this? Locking programs was more complex than TM. The TM teams combined transactions and locks. And then there was a code inspection afterwards. There's no need to go too much into the detail about that. But this part was interesting, the programming effort. So reading about, there was reading, searching for libraries, design, implementations, additional experiments, then testing, debugging, and others. The L1, L3, L2s are the lock teams. The TM1, TM2, TM3 are the transactional memory teams. The interesting data from here is that there was significant, so where the lock team spent 59%, TM team here spent 31% of the time reading. And in this area, in terms of reading, implementation, okay, debugging, and ultimately overall, they spend less time for transactional memory. The big thing, of course, is debugging segmentation faults. The lock team spent about 55 hours of the time, TM team about 23 hours.
It's primarily influenced by the log-containing parallel constructs. Okay, I'm not gonna go through all of this, but there is something. So I wanna get to the performance aspect. I've so far been showing usability. General conclusion is it is eminently usable. Is it fast enough? So there are many different STMs out there with different goals, and these are some of the listings of them. These are pure software implementation. So how to choose? And that's one of the hard part is how to choose. Do you need an adaptive algorithm? Do you need additional safety guarantees? Okay. There are commercial hardware now, and this lists some of them. I've already talked about the Azure lock elision mechanism. AMD has this advanced synchronization facility. I never really know where AMD is going, so I can't tell. Sun's Rock has been canceled, although not officially. IBM had the BlueJeans implementation in supercomputing, which has transactional memory since 2011. I worked on that. Intel just in 2012 issued TSX, codename Haswell. Now, last week, they issued an announcement saying that someone, after a year of using that, found a bug in a user. And now they use firmware code to disable TM if you really care about it. There's a solution to it, and Intel has it. And they wanted to put it into the next generation, which is Broadwell. Unfortunately, Broadwell had already gone to Silicon, so they can't. So they're going to try to put it in the next one after that. Okay. So it's something they know about. They know how to solve it. Okay. I can't reveal details because I'm not allowed to know either. And even if I knew, I shouldn't. Because it's Intel's secret. But I view that as good. That means that somebody was really hammering it hard, and they actually didn't find it even in lab testing. And I'm really, I'm anticipating to hear more detail about that when Intel is willing to reveal more details about that. IBM, we put in transactional memory in the latest generation of the mainframes, as well as the Power 8 Power PC systems. HTM fundamentally will only improve existing STM, but the specification doesn't rely on having HTM. It could be a pure software implementation. There are many compilers. Intel's STM compiler, I worked on this AlphaWorks STM compiler. The GCC compiler, incidentally, since 4.7 has transactional memory in it. And it turns out that because of all the backward flip-flops through the standard committee, they didn't like this one that one. It turns out that it ended up settling back to exactly pretty much what GCC implemented. And they implemented based on an earlier adaptation of our specification. Okay. The guy on GCC who implemented is on our group. And the next compiler from IBM has it. So the Intel compiler has 12.2, also has this, all based on an earlier draft of the specification. They have some extra things, though. Because they were trying to experiment with various things. And part of the big thing is, of course, is the rollback capability. Okay, you've all heard that transactional memory, if it reaches contention, it rolls back. How do you visualize this? I was trying to find the graphics, but I couldn't. But anyway, I ran out of time. But somebody talked about, if you think about logs like traffic lights, it's actually a really good analogy. You come to an intersection, you see a traffic light. If it's green, you go. If it's red, you don't go. Well, you know what transactional memory is like? It's like you're driving in a city and you ignore all the traffic lights. You just go through, okay? So you might ask, well, what happened if someone comes the other way and it might T-bone you? Well, the transactional memory system, the way it works is, just as he's about to T-bone you, you just back out, go back into the intersection, into your street. That's how TM works. That car now gets through, and then now you try again and go through. Now this obviously worked great on some streets, but not so great if you're like in the center of town, right? That's high contention for you. That's TM is. That ability to back out of the intersection is called rollback, okay? And that's all it is. It's like being able to drive through the city without stopping for any traffic lights. And you're protected even if somebody is about to hit you. I love that car. Now you might say rollback is great, but that doesn't work for everything. And what's one of the things that it doesn't work for? Well, what you do is irrevocable. Printing to the screen is irrevocable. A very common action. Issuing an exception, a signal. You'd be amazed how many things in the world is actually an irrevocable action, right? So we have solutions for that too.
we've been working on something called RAP, which says that what if we issue some sort of correcting action, even if it's irrevocable? Can you like unprint the screen by erasing it? Yeah, you could. It's potentially possible if you keep it in a buffer and don't issue it. What about this one? Launching a nuclear missile. Is that an irrevocable action? Well, what if you shoot it at some embassy and you want to reverse that decision at some point? This is the countermanding action that you can do. It's not quite that good, obviously. It doesn't really work well. Okay. So there was a study using a Quake game server. You guys all heard of Quake. I played it when I had a lot of time, not anymore. But it turns out that they actually adapted a Quake server to it so that they can actually be able to do collision detections. And this is the kind of things you have to do when you're playing a game. You might be moving, you might be looking at objects, collecting some health, picking up some bullets. Okay. And the way you do it is you have to lock various objects along the way. Okay. And there might be a conflicting player action coming along another corridor, and you have to account for that. Okay. And this is where you need to synchronize. And as you move along, you might have moving, charging weapons, and shooting. And the requirement, of course, is consistency and atomicity of the whole game action. So this study was actually done in my hometown, University of Toronto. And currently what people do is the conservative action acquires all the locks at the beginning of the action. This causes problems in terms of unnecessarily long conflict durations. Not a great solution. Okay. The other problem is that it gives you unnecessarily high numbers of locked objects. We're talking about real-world applications here. And in a way, this is why I kind of got into the game bar thing, because they are interested in transactional memory. I got a query from the Unreal guy about this, the Unreal Engine guy. So what about fine-grained locking? Can you lock each sub-action individually? Well, the problem is now you have no atomicity for the whole action. Okay. So fine-grained locking is not possible because you're going to get deadlocks and inconsistent views because you might forget to lock and then unlock. So this is where transaction can come in. Okay. It can solve the deadlock, the atomicity, and handle atomically the resulting action. So they did a lot of study, and the only thing I'm going to show you was the scalability. Okay, on the left is using locks and threads. On the right is using this pure STM implementation for performance. The thing I'm looking for is how well does it scale and does it do better in the total absence of hardware transactional memory. And indeed it did. STM scales better in all three contention scenarios. The processing time though, in one thread, STM, the red thing, was worse when there's only one thread, but rapidly become faster than logs for 3, 4 to 8 threads. That's what we want to see as a convincing data. Now, I really overused my time, so I'm going to hit the language constructs right away. So this is it. This is what you sat here for 45 minutes to hear. Sorry. But this stuff is publicly available, and I'm going to give more and more talks on it. So what are we putting in? This one. An atomic no-accept capability for pure atomic transactions. So by pure, I mean these things will roll back. So this, when we took it to the standard, they said, we like this, but we like something simpler. Something that is called, it's just a more advanced form of atomics that will be composable, okay, but doesn't roll back. So this is why we created this facility called Synchronize. In an earlier iteration, it was called Atomic Transaction Relax or something like that. It was relaxed because it actually relaxes the constraint from a pure transaction. It doesn't roll back. It doesn't have any of the additional machineries of rollback, but it does give you composability. Okay, and Herb was really big on that. This should be the key thing that should be at least be in the standard going forward. You can do this fairly. Implementation is fairly easy on that on synchronize. There's been a lot of experience with that. BlueJean, by the way, only does synchronize. Okay, and all that means is that it's going to give you composability, but as soon as you have some irrevocable action, it goes serial because it's implemented using a single global lock, what they call SGL semantics. Okay, so it sounds bad, but it will give you the kind of things that we want to get to next. Okay, There are a couple of keywords, transaction safe and unsafe, because it turns out that in transactions, you have to find out what is safe and what is unsafe. And this is that viral thing, static checking, that I was talking about. Okay. And this is what code would look like. Okay. And there it is. You can't have any defaults. You have to tell me whether there's no exception inside that code, or whether that code is supposed to commit if an exception occurs, or whether that code is supposed to roll back and cancel if an exception occurs. Now here's some just quick thought. Why is it that some people want the thing to commit? Because it doesn't make sense. It's an atomic transaction and an exception occurs and you want to commit everything up to just that point. Go ahead.
You actually expect to get the exception in the end anyway. So.
Right. Some people expect to get the exception and because they consider it as a kind of a control flow. Right. Some people do use exception that way. I know some people scoff at that, but that aside. Atomic cancel means that if an exception occurs, everything you've done up to meeting that exception gets rolled back. Okay? It's what you normally think atomic transactions do. No except is a very simple idea. You promise that there's no exception inside of this. And if there is one, you break the contract, well, hell will freeze over and you won't know what happened other than 500 golf balls might be delivered to you on Tuesday. Synchronize is even simpler. Okay? I still have the old words in there. So here's some of the text that goes along with it. Okay, that gives you an example. But I'm going to go through some quick examples. If you have an I/O without transactions here, printing a hello world, and let's ignore the fact that a stream is not synchronized, is not synchronized locked yet, so you might get these letters in different combinations. But assume you do. If you run this in thread one and thread two, you're going to get something that looks like this. Okay. Or something that looks like that. All valid. Okay. And other fun variations. But if you put this as a transaction, say something like a no accept, you might get that. Anyone know why you might get three of them? Thank you. One of them rolled back. Right? It's hitting the same buffer. There's a contention that just happened. One of them rolled back and now printed it again. You actually don't want this. So, how would you do that correctly? Well, this is where synchronize comes in. Okay? If you use synchronize on that, you get exactly what you want. This is the only possible answer because there's no rollback in that one. Now you see why they made us put synchronize in. Okay? It is possible to have atomic to use atomics inside transactions and logs. It's not in the specification yet because you might actually want to communicate with something outside of your transaction here. Okay. Now, transaction function call safety. You have there's a thing about identifying your functions as being transaction safe so that it can be embedded inside of a pure atomic transaction. For synchronized, it doesn't matter. You can put anything. You can put the printf in synchronized, as I know, but you cannot put that printf inside of an atomic transaction. That means it's left up to just pure computations only, or you have to identify your function virally as transaction safe. When you say it's transaction safe, you're promising a couple of things. Okay, I'm going to skip past that. It means that you have no accesses to volatile objects, no assembler language statement, and no calls to another unsafe function. Another unsafe function. It's transitive. Okay, things that break atomicity cannot be declared safe and cannot be put in an atomic transaction. Like right now, synchronizing operations. In future, we might remove that. I/O functions, okay? And that's basically it. Now there is one little, so for instance, that little thing is clearly transaction safe because you can see it, right? But for certain templates, you actually have to be very careful to identify it properly, okay? How am I doing?
5 minutes.
5 minutes, thank you. What about exceptions, okay? Here's a simple atomic cancel, and there's a little bit of wrinkle in the transaction there. When the integer escapes the transaction, should the effect of x plus plus be committed, or should it be rolled back? And we talked about this. Okay. Clearly, there's active debate. So we support both semantics in this way. You can't actually just say atomic by itself, because that's a compile failure. Okay, because it also doesn't even work with the normal C++ 11 atomic, because that needs an angle bracket after that, right? So there's no ambiguity there, all right? Here's a commit on no on exception case. So you say atomic no except, and you catch the exception inside, no problem. It doesn't, nothing is escaping. If you say atomic commit and you have some exception throwing functions, it's just going to commit when it throws that exception. Atomic cancel is trickier, because here, if you throw something, you're never going to reach your catch statement inside. It's got to be caught outside, all right? But the problem is this. When you throw this atomic statement, this exception object, what happens to what's inside the transaction? It gets rolled back, including the exception object itself. It's like a black hole, right? Nothing comes out. You can't tell. So because of that objects, we cannot transmit exception objects around. We still can't figure out how to solve this problem. So right now, the specification limits it to enums and integrals, because those things can come out. It's like synchrotron radiation. Some things can come out of a black hole, but only very simple things. Sorry? Exactly, because they're in registers. They can live on. But objects that have different parts of it will never come out whole. So there is this restriction that says you cannot throw some complicated exception state because it's going to crash. All right. I've got a couple of minutes left. I'll just say where we are right now. 2014, Monday, I'm going to have a core wording review. It's going to be the third one. And if that goes through and all these other steps goes through, I'm going to have a 3 to 6 month preliminary draft technical specification ballot. And then if that goes well, 2015, we're going to have a draft technical specification issued. That's actually not that far away, given the fact that we've been working on this for over 6 years. Questions? I'm done. Thank you very much. Questions? Yes, sir.
Trouble understanding how you can detect conflicts in software without any hardware support.
Okay, that's going to get into a bit of implementations. But if you have conflicts in software, there's a whole conflict detection mechanism. This is how things update. But the conflict detection mechanism handles conflicts between transactions. So what they do is they maintain what's called a read and a write set. Okay. And then they use bloom filters to keep scanning this read and write set to see when the conflicts occur. It's actually fairly simple. You can understand it. But there are some trickiness with different cases, whether you use the conflict to do the conflict detection immediately, or you wait until the whole transaction is done and then do the detection later. It turns out that if you do it later, you can maintain forward progress guarantee, which is a very important part of transactional memory. Whereas if you do it too early, you might ping pong back and forth between read conflicts and write conflicts, and there's no forward progress guarantee. So different, that's an STM implementation detail, and most of them have a switch to allow you to go either early detection or late detection.
So then you have to store a copy of the original data so that you can...
Right. Now you guys are digging into implementation too. I prepared myself for it because, you know, some people might care. So you could either do the update early where you maintain what's called an undo log. And if you maintain an undo log, then committing a transaction is fast because you're actually already writing in place. Rolling back is slow because now you've got to dump the undo log back where it was. The other way is the lazy update. Okay? You just keep whatever updates in this write buffer constantly. And in that case, the opposite is faster now because you're keeping all these writes in the update. To commit something, you've got to do work to dump it all in. If you want to roll back, no problem. Just throw away the write buffer. Yes, sir.
How big is the rollback buffer?
So how big is a rollback buffer? That's another implementation detail. Some people can keep, that's why they call it the overfilled spill. Okay, it could be 15K, it could be 256K. You know, it all depends on what the implementation or the software can give you. Okay, next. Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. In spite of the complexity of his solution, he even admitted at the end that it wasn't suitable for anything more complex than a binary search tree.
Right.
If a balance tree wouldn't work.
Balance tree wouldn't work.
The hash table wouldn't work. Yeah. But this works for
For the, all of those cases. Thank you. Yeah. The comment was that even with RCU, as complex it was, it really wasn't suitable for many other cases. Balance trees and things like that, where you have to keep rebalancing and things like that. He has various tricks to get around that. And I still don't understand those tricks personally. But that's kind of, I kind of see where that's going to go. Any other questions? I think I'm done. All right, well, thank you very much. Enjoy the last bit of the conference. Get in touch with me if you're interested in this stuff, want to give me some usage experience, and thank you very much for coming.